So last time we are looking at the Lagrangian and the Eulerian descriptions for the deformation. So this, let us draw the coordinate system. So this is, let's call it E1, E2, E3. This is the canonical basis, and we have the reference configuration here. So this is, let me call this as V0. This is the reference configuration. And then there is a deformed configuration. So so we introduced this mapping in the last class, which is x is equal to chi of x comma t. So this is, as I said, this is assumed to be a one-to-one map. Chi is assumed to be one-to-one, and hence you can invert this particular mapping also. So you can also write x is equal to chi inverse of x comma t. Okay, so you can so if you are given capital X, then you can find out what is small x, that is the position of the point in the deformed configuration. So here, this one here is the deformed configuration. And if you are given small x, then you can find out this capital X using this inverse transformation. So actually the problem would be to find this particular mapping, right? So if you are given, so if you last time I had given you an example of a cantilever beam, where so this is the reference configuration now before the application of the loads, right? So this is your V0. Let us call this as V0. Then if you now apply some load to this particular structure, then it deforms. Load, and now this is your V of t, which is now the deformed configuration. So actually, the whole problem is to find out this mapping chi of x of t, right? So that's actually the problem. So so for that purpose, we will set up a set of partial differential equations, which has to be solved along with proper initial and boundary conditions. But that we will come to at a later stage. Right now, as I said, that we will just worry about this kinematics here. So this is so this x, as we said last time, these are material coordinates. Material coordinates, and your small x, spatial coordinates. The formulation in terms of this capital X is known as the Lagrangian formulation. Okay, so formulation in terms of capital X is known as a Lagrangian formulation. The formulation in terms of small x is known as an Eulerian formulation. Eulerian formulation. So yes. Yeah, so in problems involving solid mechanics, we generally prefer the Lagrangian formulation. Okay, because see, you know. So suppose if you take this example of a cantilever beam, right? You know what the initial position of this cantilever beam is before the application of the loads. So you know this capital X. Okay, in this particular case, what the capital X is, you know this particular thing because you know the reference configuration before the application of the loads. But in problems in fluid mechanics, typically we would prefer the Eulerian formulation. Okay, so suppose basically if you are studying, let's say, the flow in some channel. Okay, so there is some flow in this channel here. Maybe the fluid is coming from some overhead tank or something like that. So typically you do not know. So the fluid is coming in here. So if typically you do not know what the starting position of that particular, suppose if you take some fluid particle here, you do not know from the original position of that fluid particle. So you do not know the capital X or the reference configuration of that fluid typically. So of course there are exceptions to this. So I will talk about those exceptions, but typically in problems in fluid mechanics, when you are talking of the flow in a particular channel or a pipe, then you know only the deformed position. Okay, as I said that you generally prefer a Lagrangian formulation for problems of solid mechanics, and you prefer the Eulerian formulation for problems in fluid mechanics. But you should realize that actually these are just two different formulations. So it's a matter of convenience. So it's not that the Lagrangian formulation is correct and the Eulerian is wrong when you are dealing with problems in solid mechanics. It is not that. It is just a matter of convenience. So what I am saying is that actually the Lagrangian and the Eulerian formulations are completely equivalent, mathematically speaking. So both of them are valid. But the only thing is that it's more convenient to use a Lagrangian formulation when you are dealing with problems in solid mechanics, and it is more convenient to use an Eulerian formulation when you are dealing with problems in fluid mechanics. But as I said, that you can use an Eulerian formulation for a solid and you can use a Lagrangian formulation for a fluid. So let me give an example where a Lagrangian formulation would be appropriate for a fluid. So suppose if you take a sloshing problem, right? If you have water in a bucket, for example. Okay, so let me just draw that. Suppose if you have a bucket like this, right? And then there is water in this. Okay? And now you just pick up the bucket. Okay, then the fluid will start sloshing in this, right? So it will just move back and forth. So that is just a common experience, right? That you have. So in this particular case, I know what the undeformed configuration is, or the reference configuration is for the fluid. So in this particular case, the Lagrangian formulation also would be appropriate for a fluid where, for example, in the sloshing type problems, it would be appropriate to use the Lagrangian formulation. So what I am trying to get at is that it is all a matter of convenience. So both these formulations, mathematically speaking, are equivalent, and so there is nothing like one is correct and the other is incorrect. So both are valid, but just we choose one of these formulations according to the convenience. Okay, so since this is a solid mechanics class, typically we will be using the Lagrangian formulation. Sort of introduce you to the Eulerian formulation, but you will see more of that in your fluid mechanics course. So at this as far as this course is concerned, we will focus almost exclusively on the Lagrangian formulation here. Fine. So that means the formulation in terms of the material coordinates, or this capital X here. Yes. So now let us look at the relation between this small x and capital X. So the difference between the deformed coordinate and the undeformed coordinate is called as the displacement vector here. So this u, which is equal to x minus x, right? So this is known as the displacement vector. Okay, displacement. Okay, so suppose, you take an example where suppose a particle starts from here, okay, and it goes around and then it comes back to the same point. Then the displacement is taken as zero. It is not taken as 2 pi r. Suppose if it is going around a circle, the displacement is not taken as the distance that the particle has traveled. It is just the final position minus the original position here. So if it comes back to the same point, the displacement is just taken as zero. Yes, that is a clarification here. Okay, then now we will introduce a quantity of fundamental importance. Okay, so this actually plays, whatever I am going to introduce, plays a very, very key role throughout our study of continuum mechanics, okay, or solid mechanics here. And this quantity is the deformation gradient. Okay, so this is a very, very important quantity, so which you should understand. So we will introduce this. Okay. So, so deformation gradient. So this is F is equal to del of chi. Okay, so now see, we have to be careful here. See, lots of gradients will be introduced. Okay, so at this particular stage, I am introducing the deformation gradient. At some other time, I will be introducing the rate of deformation tensor, which is also a gradient, or the velocity gradient, and so on. So I will be introducing lots of gradients. Okay, so sometimes these gradients are with respect to capital X. Sometimes the gradients are with respect to small x. So what I will do is, to keep the notation, okay, so just so that there is no confusion in the notation, I will indicate that, you know, with the subscript x, okay, that the gradient is with respect to capital X. Okay, so so later on we will be studying the velocity gradient. So there the gradient will be with respect to small x. Okay, so so this is something. So this whenever there is a gradient, I will try to specify that it is with respect to capital X or small x by putting this subscript on the gradient. Yeah. And this chi is our mapping, right? So this x is equal to chi of x comma t. So just one small point here is that sometimes books may write this as del x of small x. Okay. So actually we should not write it in this particular way. Just because, see, this x actually represents the position vector. So it is the value of this function. Okay, so if you evaluate this function at a given capital X and t, then this is the value of that particular function. So whenever we talk of differentiation, actually we are not differentiating the value, but we are differentiating the function itself. So this is exactly analogous to, see, many times we write dy by dx, right? But actually what we mean is that this y is, suppose, f of x, then we actually want to differentiate the function, right? So actually we want to differentiate the function, not the value of that function. Okay, so in exactly the same way, it is not appropriate to write it as del chi of x, although sometimes books may write it like this, but sort of, here it is understood that actually you are differentiating the function and not the value. But we will try to be precise, and then so this chi is the mapping, right? That is a function. So we'll see examples of this mapping. So at this stage, it may seem abstract, you know, what this mapping means. But at a later stage, we will look at examples of several mappings for let's say rigid motion or uniaxial extension of a bar and so on and so forth. So we'll look at those examples at a later stage. But at this stage, we are just simply differentiating this mapping here. Okay, so I wanted to make this difference clear between differentiating the value of a function and the function itself. So here we are differentiating the function, so this chi. So now remember that this chi itself is a vector and this x is also a vector. So basically this generates a second order tensor here. So this Fij, so if I write this in initial notation, so this is Fij is del chi I by del xj. So let me write out the components of this particular matrix. So this would be del chi 1 by del x1, del chi 1 by del x2, del chi 1 by del x3, del chi 2 by del x1, del chi 2 by del x2, del chi 2 by del x3, and del chi 3 by del x1, del chi 3 by del x2, del chi 3 by del x3. Okay, so this is the matrix with 9 components. So this is the deformation gradient. Okay, and this deformation gradient plays a very, very key role in defining the various strain measures or rate of strain measures and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is a very, very fundamentally important quantity here. One thing you have to note is that it is not symmetric in general. I mean, for some special situation it may be symmetric, but in general it is not symmetric here. Okay. Then we will call the determinant of f as j. So this is determinant f, and we will we will impose this restriction that J is greater than 0. So I will come to this restriction, I mean the justification for this restriction at a later stage. Okay, so that actually requires the relation between volume elements in the reference configuration and the volume element in the deform configuration. So I will come to that at a later stage, but at this particular stage we will not go into the proof of this particular thing. So this is also known as an orientation preserving condition. Orientation preserving condition. So actually later on we will see that the volume element, so suppose if you take this as the reference configuration and if you take this as dv0 and if you take the deform configuration and you take a volume element dv, then the dv is equal to j times dv0. So as I said, I will show this relation at a later stage, so but I'm just trying to give you some justification. So so what happens is that at time t equal to 0, so suppose if I plot this, right, at time t equal to 0, so this is your time and this is your j, for example. So at time t equal to 0, your j is equal to 1 because your reference, so this deform configuration is coinciding with the reference configuration at time t equal to 0. So your so basically at this, your x is equal to capital X in that, and so this implies that your f is equal to identity tensor, right? And so this implies that your j is equal to 1. So this is at time t equal to 0. At t equal to 0, this is what happens, right? So now you can imagine that in order to become negative, right, it has to cross this particular thing. So if it becomes 0, if j becomes 0, right, then you will get that dv is equal to 0. But so although mathematically this is allowed, but physically we cannot allow that the volume element goes to 0. So this argument that this j greater than 0, this orientation preserving condition comes from the physics. So mathematics allows that j be 0, but physics doesn't allow that. So this is a physically reasonable assumption. So we don't allow it to cross. So basically it starts here and it can be only a continuous function of time. So basically what we are saying is that it remains positive all through all the deformation. And so this is known as an, so the reason for calling it as an orientation preserving condition is that you imagine that there is a set of axes that is embedded in a body, correct? So let's take that, suppose you can imagine that there are three axes that are embedded in this duster. Now you imagine that this duster is undergoing some deformation, no? So like this. Now suppose if there is this block, right, and it is undergoing some deformation like this, okay, and so this coordinate system will also get deformed along with that. So you imagine that this coordinate system is embedded in the body that is deforming. So even after this body deforms, right, a right-handed coordinate system will remain a right-handed coordinate system. So it doesn't go into a reflection, for example. And so so that is physically, that is the meaning of this orientation preserving. Orientation preserving means a right-handed coordinate system doesn't go to a left-handed coordinate system, and so on. Okay, so that's what we mean, that if you embed a coordinate system, it maintains its orientation. So that is the idea here behind this orientation preserving condition. Okay, now let us try to see the relation between the deformation gradient and the displacement gradient, right? Okay, so let us talk about that now. Yes, so we have this relation that x is equal to capital X plus u. Now, as I said, that this x is equal to, so this is also equal to chi of x cosine. So if I now take the gradient of this, so then I get that f ij, that is equal to del chi I by del xj, which is equal to del xi by del xj plus del ui by del xj. In initial notation, this is what I get. Now, this del xi by del xj is nothing but delta ij. This is delta ij plus this is del u, so with respect to capital X, ij. And so this is your fij is simply delta ij. So this actually you can see, you can write, you can see that this particular relation holds. So suppose if you differentiate del x1 with respect to del x1, you will get 1. So that is 1, 1. But if you differentiate del x1 with respect to del x2, that is 0. So you will get 1, 2, the delta 1, 2, which is 0. So so you can see that this relation holds. And then similarly, this del u of I by del xj is the gradient. And again, I am indicating that the gradient is with respect to capital X by putting this subscript here. So in tensorial form, I can write this as f is equal to I plus del x of u. So this is a very, very fundamental relation between the deformation gradient and the displacement gradient here. Right, now, so using this definition of the deformation gradient and the displacement gradient, now we will start to define what we mean by a strain measure. Okay? So in your strength of materials classes, you have defined a strain loosely speaking as a change in length per unit length, okay, in the case of normal strain components, or in the case of shear strain components as a change in angle, right, from pi by 2. Let us say if you have a block, the block I showed, it is deforming under shear. So the change in angle from pi by 2, that we called as the shear strain component, right? So you'll see that these definitions are fairly loose, in the sense that suppose if I give you an arbitrarily defining body in 3D, it is very difficult to say what this change in length is per unit length, or very difficult to say what the change in angle is at that particular point. So basically we need more mathematically precise definitions of what we mean by a strain measure. Okay, and so now we are in a position to define in a more precise way what we mean by a strain measure here. Fine, so we will start with that now, how to define a strain, right? So I will talk about now a length measure, okay, length measures, a length element. Length element transformation. So you have a undeformed configuration here, and now let us call this as an element of length dx. Okay. So this is like an element. So you can think about this as maybe part of some curve. This is an infinitesimal quantity. Okay. So this is exactly like you write integral of sine x dx, right? So this dx that you write as a differential. So this is exactly like that. Okay, so this is a differential. So you can think of it as an element along some curve in the reference configuration or something like that. Okay. The main thing to remember here is that this dx is a scalar differential, but here we are talking of a vector differential, because this capital X is a vectorial quantity. So this dx is an element in the reference configuration. And then now you can imagine that this undergoes some deformation. So now in the deformed configuration, it goes to an element of length d small x. So again you can imagine that this d small x is again some part of some curve or something like that in the deformed configuration here. Now, what is the relation between this d of small x and this d of capital X? So let us write that. So this dxi, you can write, is del chi I by del xj times dxj. So here, I am simply applying the chain rule. Okay. So this is not an approximation. So th- So this is exact. This is an exact differential. Okay, so that is what you have to remember. So for example, if I had that, let's say y, right, is equal to e to the x, right, then I would write this as dy is equal to e to the x dx, right. So in exactly the same way, I am just writing this using the chain rule. Now you may question that what happens to the time part of this, right? Because we have said that this chi is a function of x comma t. So you're right that there should also be a part associated with dt also. But you assume that so right now actually we are interested only in the length changes. Okay, so you can assume that the time is kept fixed when I am doing this differentiation. Okay, so that is why we are not allowing this time. So that actually derivative with respect to time we will be considering separately when we do the velocity. So at this stage you can assume that the time is like a fixed quantity. So you are just looking at it at some fixed time and just looking at the changes in the length. Okay, so you are not worried about the other part of this chain rule here. So as I said, that this is an exact equation. Okay, so you should not think that this is the first term in some Taylor series expansion or something like that. This is an exact relation between two differentials, just exactly like in this particular case here, whatever I've shown. So if I write this in vector form or tensor form, then I can write this as dx is equal to f times dx, right? Because this del chi I by del xj is nothing but a deformation gradient here. So you can write now this relation between an element of length in the undeformed configuration and the deformed configuration. So they are linked through the deformation gradient, as you can see here. Fine. Now we will now look at what we mean by change in the length of an element here. Right. So now let us take the. So suppose if you think of the length of this as ds and the length of this particular element as d small s, okay, then we can write the ds square minus ds square that you can think of as the change in the length squares, okay, that you can think of as this change in length dx dot dx minus dx dot dx. And now we have this relation, so we'll just substitute for the dx. So this is f times dx dot f times dx minus dx dot dx. Okay. And this I can write as equal to, use the definition of the transpose. So I can write this as dx dot f transpose f minus identity times dx capital. So you can think of this as that there is an I sitting here. Okay, so this is dx dot I dx. So that I you can put it here. Okay, so just you can think of it in that particular way here. And this I will write as dx dot c minus I times dx. Okay, so now where I am now defining this c to be, so c definition is f transpose f. Okay, so this is known as the Wright-Cauchy-Green strain tensor. So right, because there is a left also, so we'll come to that at a later stage, but right now this is the thing. And you can also write this, so this colon equal to means definition. Okay, so that is all you have to bear in mind. So this quantity f transpose f that I am getting, that I am calling as this c. So because these quantities like f transpose f will occur many times, and so this is just a shorthand for every time we don't want to keep on writing f transpose f. Instead of that, we will just write it as c. So that is the reason that we will introduce this new notation, and we will also introduce this notation that 2dx dot e times dx. Okay, so this e times dx. So this e is the Lagrangian measure of strain here. So this E is equal to half of C minus I. Okay. And this is known as the Green strain tensor. Green strain tensor. And this is a Lagrangian measure of strain. Lagrangian measure of strain. Okay, so why is this a measure of strain, first of all? Okay, so you can think of this, that this is some kind of a change in length. See now, because we are dealing with tensorial quantities, right, it is not possible to have exactly change in length per unit length. Okay, so that is ruled out, because as I said, that you are dealing with tensorial quantities here. So you can think of this as, you know, this is some original length, correct? So this is original length square, you can think. So this is like change in length per some original length square. Okay, so this C minus I, this quantity that you are seeing, is some measure of strain, or this E, for example, right? So you can think of this as, this is like a change in length square divided by the change in length square. So this E, that is why it is a measure of strain, this Lagrangian measure of strain. And this 2 here, right, that 2 is just kept there for historical reasons. Okay, so historical, because you will see that the small strain tensor is an approximation to this E if you put the factor 2. If you don't put this factor 2, then you will not get that as an approximation. So historically, the small strain tensor, which we have not yet defined. So historically speaking, the small strain tensor was defined first, and then this large deformation, this Lagrangian measure of strain, came later. Okay, so in order that the small strain tensor be an approximation of the large strain tensor, this 2 factor is introduced. So this 2 factor is not very important from a mathematical perspective, but as I said, that just to get that approximation, we introduce this factor 2. So to summarize here, basically this E is sort of, it gives you sort of the change in length per unit length kind of thing, right? So as I said, that in a tensor framework, it is not possible to exactly get your strength of materials definition. So this is what we can do. Another very important point to remember is that there are infinite number of strain measures that are possible. Okay, so after this, I will define another measure of strain, which is the Eulerian measure of strain. Or there can be, you know, lots and lots of other strain measures. You can have a log of C as a strain measure, and so on and so forth. Okay, so we will not go into all the strain measures that are possible, because as I said, there are an infinite number of strain measures. So we will look at what exactly characterizes a strain measure at a later stage, but at this stage, this is one strain measure that I have introduced. Okay, and this is probably the only one that we will use in this class. So this class is an introductory class, so probably this is the only measure that we will use. And then actually, when we linearize this, okay, so to get the small strain tensor approximation, then actually there is uniqueness, in the sense, then for the small strain case, there is only one strain measure. Okay, so at this stage, let us not worry about the infinite number of strain measures that are possible and so on. So this is the one that we will typically use. As I said, that this is known as the Green strain tensor. And why is it called as a Lagrangian measure of strain? So let us look at that. So basically, you will see that it involves this deformation gradient, right? And that is all this deformation gradient, if you recall, that is with respect to capital X, right? So this of chi. So all the gradients that are appearing in this measure of strain are with respect to capital X, and hence it is called as a Lagrangian measure of strain. So there will be an Eulerian measure of strain where the gradients will be with respect to small x. Okay, so we will not, as I said, we will come to that, but at this particular stage, this is the gradient that we are, this is the measure of strain that we are introducing here. Fine, then now let us look at an alternative way of doing the same derivation here. Fine, so In this particular case, we have said that dx is equal to f times dx, right? So this so here, we already said that from a physical perspective, your j has to be greater than 0, right? So this is j is equal to det f is greater than 0. We already said that. So if the determinant is greater than 0, that means your f is invertible, correct? And so throughout this course now, without every time explicitly mentioning it, we will assume that f is invertible. Okay, so every time I will not mention that f is invertible and so on. So directly I will write f inverse, because once and for all, throughout this course now, we have j greater than 0, and so f inverse will exist. So if I multiply both sides by f inverse, then I will get that dx is equal to f inverse times dx. So this I can write the inverse relation in this particular case. And then now the same relation, right, this let me just rewrite it in a different, slightly different way now, using this inverse relation. So ds square minus ds square is equal to dx dot dx minus, so now instead of this dx dot dx, so I'll let me write it as f inverse times dx dot f inverse times dx. So this I can write it in this particular way. Now again use the definition of the transpose and so on. So you can write this as dx dot I minus f inverse transpose f inverse times dx. So again use the definition of the transpose and then write it in this particular way. This is equal to dx dot I minus B inverse times dx. Okay. So just like we defined this C as the right Cauchy-Green strain tensor, now we are defining this B, which is FF transpose. So B is defined as F times F transpose. So this is known as the left Cauchy-Green strain tensor. So left Cauchy-Green strain tensor. And this is an Eulerian measure of strain, so we'll come to that. But so let me just write this as also dx dot, 2 times dx dot E bar times dx. So this E bar now is known as the Almanzi strain tensor. So let me write it here, create some space here. This E bar. E bar. Okay, so this E bar is known as Almanzi strain tensor, right? And so this E bar is half of I minus B inverse. So in terms of the left Cauchy-Green strain tensor, you can write this E bar as this particular tensor here. Okay, and you can express this in terms of the displacement gradients. So there you will see that actually when you write it in terms of the displacement gradient, you will see that the gradient is now with respect to small x, and hence actually you can say that this is an Eulerian measure of strain. Okay, so this is an Eulerian measure of strain. So as I mentioned that typically in this course we will be following only the Lagrangian measure of strain. So for our purposes actually this is not going to be so much relevant. This E is equal to half of C minus I is what we will typically use, but you should know that this is so what an Eulerian measure of strain, because here I have introduced what a Lagrangian measure of strain is. So you should also know what an Eulerian measure of strain is. So that's why I'm just introducing it. But we will not use this in this particular code. But you can already see that I have introduced two measures of strain. But as I said, there can be an infinite number of measures of strain. Again, we will not get into that, but just mentioning it, that is a piece of information here. The two strain measures, this E bar and this E, they are related to each other. So, so here you can see that this E bar, let me just write that here again, E bar is, is equal to half of I minus F inverse transpose F inverse. Okay, so this, if you multiply by F transpose on the left hand side and F on the right hand side, then what you will get is that E is equal to F transpose times E bar times F. Okay, so if you just multiply it on both sides, then you will see that you will get back this E is equal to half of F transpose F minus identity. So just multiply. So you can see that these two strain measures are linked to each other, right? So actually, you will see that if E bar vanishes, right? If E bar is zero, then E is zero, and if E is zero, then E bar is zero. Okay, because so that is actually one of the features of all strain measures. So I said there are an infinite number of strain measures, right? So if one of the strain measure vanishes, then all the other strain measures will also vanish. Okay, so that is the characteristic of that. So the reason why that happens, we'll come to that in a short while. But first, let me just write what the relations are between this E, which is the Lagrangian measure of strain, and the displacement gradient. Okay, so we have seen that E is equal to, so let me just make some space here, E is equal to half of, F transpose F minus identity. We have seen this. Now, if you substitute, F is equal to I plus del U, right? If you substitute that, and then you will see that the I will cancel electron. So then what you will get is that E is equal to half of del U plus del U transpose plus del U transpose del U. Okay, so all these gradients are with respect to capital X. So this is the relation between the Lagrangian measure of strain or the Green strain tensor and the displacement gradient. So you can see that it's a nonlinear function of the displacement gradient, because you have a term like this, right, which is a quadratic term here, right? So actually this part is linear. So linear in the sense that if you take U as U1 plus U2, for example, right, then the strains due to these U1 and U2, you can just simply add if you take only these first two terms. But you cannot add the strains due to the U1 and U2 because of this nonlinear term. So when you are considering the full nonlinear term, you cannot get the total strain simply by adding the two individual strains due to U1 and U2. Correct? So that because of this nonlinearity here. So it becomes a nonlinear function. Now, one of the sort of misconceptions that students have is that this is like a Taylor series approximation. Okay, so what they tend to think is that this is the sort of the first order term in a Taylor series, and then this is the second order Taylor, and actually it is infinity and we are chopping it off. That is not true. Okay, so what I mean to say is that this is an exact measure of strain. Okay, so it stops at quadratic, that's it. So there are no more terms like cubic and higher order terms. Okay, so this is, as I said, that see, that comes because we are assuming this ds square as our length element, right? So that it comes because of that, right? So that you get this quadratic and that's it. And then similarly, you also have, if you express E bar in terms of the displacement gradient, then you will get that is D del x of u plus del x of u transpose minus del x of u times del x of u. So here the gradients you can see are with respect to small x, because that is an Eulerian measure of strain that I already mentioned. But as I said that, you know, you can sort of forget about this particular expression because we are not going to use this much. But I'm just pointing out that in the Lagrangian framework, the gradients or the formulation is with respect to capital X. And in the Eulerian formulation, the gradients are all going to be with respect to small x, right, with the spatial position. But in problems in solid mechanics, as I said, that the reference configuration is known. So this x will be known, and so we will prefer to use this particular formulation. So we will stop at this particular stage here.